welcome to this evening, which is one of the most wonderful concerts that we put on every year with Esteli Gomez. This is her 12th year with us. And by the end of this concert, she will have premiered 96 works by our students. She's not only one of the very finest sopranos in the world, triple Grammy winner, as a matter of fact, but she's also an amazing teacher and mentor. And we have just had the most incredible week. The 8 songs that you'll hear were first mentored by our faculty. Together we prepare the songs, and then she takes them further as someone who can work with each composer on so many of the aspects of their music, help them to understand from a singer's perspective what makes a great art song. And you're going to hear phenomenal performances tonight. We have a wonderful week of rehearsals and of the kind of teaching that you rarely see. I wish more universities would be able to have someone at the level of Esteli that could actually give students this kind of engagement in the art of song. It's so wonderful that we're able to do it. So we offer it to you tonight. I thank you so much for coming. And I want to say a special thanks to Esteli for all that she continues to give to our students and to our university. Thank you so much.
Good evening. Welcome, everyone. My name is Connor Weir. I am the first composer on this concert. Again, I also want to say thank you to Esteli. It has been such an inspirational thing to work with Esteli and Grant this week. They've really brought life to my music in a way that I haven't experienced for a while. So thank you, guys. You've been inspiring me. The title of my piece is Vox Caritas Dei, which means the voice of God's love. And this piece of music frames a particular word that has a lot of baggage in today's culture, and that's repentance. There's a lot of negative connotations with that word. And so in this song, I set the text of Psalm 51, which is very commonly associated with repentance and the season of Lent, which we are in right now. And this song emphasizes the mercy of God, the difficulty of sin, and the need to truly repent, but not because we fear hell, but rather because God created us for greatness. He knows that the disordered comforts that the evil one offers us are not things that actually satisfy us, even though it seems like it. And so repentance focuses less on condemnation and more on turning to a deeper personal relationship with a God who loves us. It means vulnerability before the Lord, accepting imperfections in ourselves, and realizing that our deep desire for perfection, it's fulfilled in God alone. The music that I wrote emphasizes this in many ways, and one is through harsh dissonances. These reflect the pain of sin and suffering in our lives, but these dissonances also extend to the happy parts, so to speak, the joyous moments, because they reflect the quality of redemptive suffering, that suffering can become something that's beautiful for our lives. And it also reflects the ultimate longing we have for that fulfillment in God. That's a reality that's only achieved after our death, that our whole life is something that leads up to that point. And that's a hopeful promise, that this life isn't everything, that there's something so much more coming forth that's going to come. And that hopeful promise is what should encourage our repentance, because it means an eternal union with the one whom our heart really loves. And so, may this music inspire in all of us the true meaning of the word repentance. For it is Vox Caritas Dei, the voice of God's love, calling us home. And now I would like to read for you the text. These are selected verses from Psalm 51 that I selected before I started writing in order to emphasize these different points that I've outlined. If you turn to the final page of your program, you can see it there. The text is in Latin, so I would like to read for you the English translation tonight. Sprinkle me with hyssop, and I shall be cleansed. Wash me, and I shall become whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness. Let the bones thou hast crushed rejoice. Create a pure heart for me, O God, and renew in me a steadfast spirit. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and strengthen me with a noble spirit. O God, thou God of my salvation, deliver me from the guilt of blood. Let my tongue rejoice because of thy justice. O Lord, thou wilt open my lips, and my mouth shall declare thy praise. Please enjoy. Thank you.
especially like to thank Esteli and Grant for their collaboration on all the pieces on tonight's program. I'd also like to thank Dr. Kerr and Dr. Crum for their instruction, insights, and patience with all the composers as we wrote these pieces over the last few months. My piece, Weep You No More, Sad Fountains, belongs to a collection of other settings of the same 16th century text to music. The first setting of this text comes from the composer John Dowland. It has been suggested that this song alludes to Queen Elizabeth I, who, after increasingly poor health, died in 1603, the same year as this song's publication. This Renaissance text saw a resurgence in popularity in the 20th century. Kate Winslet sings, Weep You No More, Sad Fountains, in the movie Sense and Sensibility, to a new setting composed by Patrick Doyle. And the musical icon Sting recorded his version in his 2006 album, Songs from the Labyrinth. My setting of this text transparently conveys the mysteries of love, faith, and death present within this poem. The instrumental prelude and postlude, played by the piano and viola, serve as three pillars supporting and framing the voice. The text is as follows. Weep you no more, sad fountains. What need you flow so fast? Look how the snowy mountains heaven's sun doth gently waste. But my son's heavenly eyes view not your weeping that now lies sleeping softly. Now softly lies sleeping. Sleep is a reconciling, a rest that peace begets. Doth not the sun rise smiling when fair at even he sets? Rest you then, rest, sad eyes. Melt not in weeping while she lies sleeping softly. Now softly lies sleeping. Thank you.
Thank you. is Calvin Rice, and I wrote the piece titled The Sea at Night. My piece is about the exploration of my spirituality and how it relates to nature. I drew on many different influences from the natural world, including my trips to the Washington and Oregon coast. It was there that I studied the ebb and flow of the ocean. I noticed that it seemed pure and natural, and so I attempted to depict that through my own music. I also took inspiration from the poet Sri Aurobindo's unique ideas about spirituality. For him, attaining a heightened consciousness by melding the physical and spiritual world is the ultimate goal of living. This is different from the more traditional Buddhist ideas, which describe the ultimate goal as freeing oneself from the physical world. Now I will read the poem. The gray sea creeps, half visible, half hushed, and grasps with its innumerable hands. These silent walls, I see beyond a rough, glimmering infinity. I feel the wash and hear the sibilation of the waves that whisper to each other as they push to shoreward side by side. Long lines and dim of movements flecked with quivering spots of foam, the quiet welter of a shifting world.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. My name is Kevin Gunya. This next song is a setting of text by Ella Wheeler Wilcox, an American poet from the late 19th century. This text is a love poem, which Wilcox likely wrote for her husband early in their marriage, and they were happily married for several decades. Wilcox's poems were certainly respected, but publishers in the late Victorian era feared that the direct, strong emotional content would cause a scandal. However, readers related to her writing, and her poetry collections sold thousands of copies. It's clear that I related to this poem very strongly, and I hope the music brings this out. Thank you to Esteli and Grant for making this song come alive, and thank you all for being here tonight.
I love when the strands in man. I'm Riley Daniels. This next one's called Musical Vomit. Musical Vomit was something a professor told to me after a premiere one time, and it was pretty hurtful. So I like to process trauma and that type of stuff through humor. And when I got the opportunity to write this piece for Esteli, for us to do together, it just worked perfectly. So I, to be honest, don't know what she's going to sing or say or any of that. We have some written out phrases, but other than that, I don't know what order she's gonna go in, what one she's gonna do, anything like that. I also have no music, so we're both kinda going off each other for the whole thing. It's gonna be a fun time. Thank you.
In the parallel universe, rubber chickens are the rulers. Psychic mind. emoji galaxy. Smiley faces negotiate peace with the winky faces.
Hello, my name is William Dickens, and I composed this next piece entitled Today I Took a Walk with My Friend. This poem was originally in French and has been translated into English, and it was written by French poet Robert Desnos. Desnos was early in his life, in the early 20th century, he was a surrealist poet and was famous for his technique of automatic writing, in which he would enter into a trance-like state and try to write down the ideas that came from his subconscious mind and from his dreamlike mind. However, as Robert Desnos got older, he abandoned surrealism and started to spend more time writing in journalism and in his poetry. It was of a more mature, more emotionally subdued, and less emotional tone, as well as more political. He became more involved in eventually the French resistance in World War II and ultimately died in a concentration camp in Czechoslovakia in 1945. This poem, Today I Took a Walk with My Friend, was one of those poems that he wrote during this time period that was not actually published until after his death in 1945. The poem tells a story of a man who is so wrought with grief over the death of his friend, unable to come to terms with that, he instead imagines that he is in the present taking a walk with him. And they go about and look at the beautiful nature and the beautiful landscapes. And during this walk, he spends the time reflecting on his youth and reflecting on his inability to deal with death during his whole life. At the end of the walk, the friend says to him, as a solemn warning, he says to him, "You too will come where I am on a Sunday or a Saturday." The poet then reflects on this. And in a sense of agreement, he looks around at the nature and suddenly sees that he's alone. I will now read the poem. Today I took a walk with my friend. Even if he's dead, I took a walk with my friend. How beautiful were the flowering trees, the chestnut trees that were snowing on the day of his death. I took a walk with my friend. In the past, my parents went alone to burials, and I felt like a little child. Now I know about death. I've seen plenty of undertakers, but I don't go near them. That's why all day today, I took a walk with my friend. He found me a bit older, but he told me, "You too will come where I am on a Sunday or Saturday." Me, I looked at the flowering trees, the river passing along the bridge, and suddenly I saw that I was alone. So I returned among the living. Thank you. I hope you enjoy my work.
Thank you. Daniel Au, and my piece is called The Rainbow. The text is by Charlotte Richardson, who was a British poet from the early 19th century. The song opens with a dramatic thunderstorm, but before long, the clouds begin to part, the sun shines through, and a rainbow appears in the sky. The singer explores the peace, beauty, and joy that the rainbow brings her in the aftermath of the storm. This piece is an extension of my admiration for the natural world and all the beauty it has to offer. I will now read the poem aloud. Soft falls the shower, the thunder cease, and see the messengers of peace illumes the eastern skies. Blessed sign of firm, unchanging love, while others seek the cause to prove that bids thy beauties rise. My soul, content with humbler views, well pleased, admires thy varied hues, and can with joy behold thy beauteous form and wondering gaze, enraptured on thy mingled rays of purple, green, and gold. Enough for me to deem divine the hand that paints each glowing line, to think that thou art given a transient gleam of that bright place where beauty owns celestial grace, a faint display of heaven.
Thank you. everyone. My name is Max Mabry. I just wanted to take a second to thank you all for coming out. This is going to be the last piece on the program tonight. Thank you so much for coming out and supporting all of us. It's so fun for us to get to see this kind of music come to life, and you guys get to be here with us while it happens. Thank you so much to Esteli and Grant and everyone else that performed tonight, too. This concert's been really, really fun. So my piece is titled I Am But Paper, and it is using a poem from a book that I got the pleasure of reaching out to the author of. He's still alive, which is a very fun thing for me as a composer, getting to work with a living author. And he gave me the go-ahead to use this poem. And so this poem was written by a character in the book. And I don't know, it just really spoke to me when I was reading through this book. It felt so human and so impactful. And this character, it meant so much to the character and then to a lot of the other people in the story. And so I tried to embody that as well as kind of give my own perspective a little bit on the poem and how it affected me in my writing. So here's the text. I am but paper, brittle and thin. I am held up to the sun, and it shines right through me. I get written on and can never be used again. These scratches are a history. They're a story. They tell things for others to read, but they only see the words and not what the words are written upon. I am a paper, and though there are many like me, none are exactly the same. I am parched parchment. I have lines. I have holes. Get me wet, and I melt. Light me on fire, and I burn. Take me in hardened hands, and I crumple. I tear. I am but paper, brittle and thin.
Sure.